Welcome aboard, shipmates. This is Operation Trident Watch, an online national monthly drill created for and by members of the United States Naval Sea Cadet Corps. I'm Warrant Officer David Sheets, and I am joined by Sea Cadet members from across the nation to bring this national drill to you. Today, I'm in downtown Cleveland, Ohio. Why am I in Cleveland, Ohio? Well, it might have something to do with these two aircraft over my shoulders. More about that in a moment. But first of all, this is a national drill, and we follow all customs and courtesies. So please join us for Morning Colors. Thank you very much to the Band of the West Division for their outstanding rendition of our national anthem. Thank you all for joining us today on Operation Trident Watch. We have 3 hours of jam-packed information and activities for you today. Glad that you're with us. So, we want you to be involved. So if you have questions or comments, put them in the comments section of both the YouTube and Facebook feeds, and we'll get them answered. Remember, stay positive, okay? Good stuff. So, without any further delay, let's find out more of what we're going to cover today. So I'm going to turn this over to our Tactical Action Officer, Ensign DePippo, who will introduce our Trident Watch Task Force members and give you the plan of the day. Ensign DePippo, take it away.
Good morning, Sea Cadet family. I am beyond excited to see you here today. I'm going to introduce our task force members. So first up, we have Warrant Officer David Sheets from Region 98 Staff, Ohio. He is out there live. myself, Ensign Brittany DePippo from Falcon Division, Rhode Island. We have Chief Petty Officer Rafe Rowles from Battleship Missouri Division, Missouri. We have Chief Petty Officer Eric Gollinge from Corporal Kyle Carpenter Division, New York. We have Chief Petty Officer Theodore Ilarionov from Mass Bay Division, Massachusetts. We have Petty Officer First Class Austin Payne from Battleship Missouri Division, Missouri. And finally, we have Petty Officer Second Class Nathan Rastovac from 911 Division, Illinois. Cadets, get ready for the best drill. No lie, this is going to be great, fantastic, the best ever. Why, may you ask? Stay tuned to find out. So starting off for our plan of the day, we're gonna have a section on the Blue Angels, the US Navy Flight Demonstration Squadron. After that, we're going to have a 10-minute break. After you come back from your break, we'll have very special guests joining us. Who might it be? You're going to have to stick around to find out. After them, we're going to have an overview on naval aviation. After that, we're going to have another 10-minute break. Make sure to get your PT gear on. After the break, we're going to have another special guest. Stay tuned. You're going to be shocked at our special guests today. And then finally, we're going to end it for time for some PT. Good for me, good for you. Let's go get it. Follow us on our social media channels. Make sure to subscribe to us on YouTube, Operation Trident Watch. Hit the bell notification to get notified when we go live. Follow us on Instagram for exclusive behind-the-scenes content, and make sure to find us on Facebook at Official OTW. And now I'm going to hand it back off to Warrant Officer Sheets. Take it away.
Thank you very much, Ensign DePippo. So, as I said at the beginning of our drill today, I'm in downtown Cleveland, Ohio. Where specifically? Well, I'm at the Burke Lakefront Airport, which is about a 10-minute walk away from the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame in downtown Cleveland. I'm here because we're going to talk about the United States Navy Blue Angels. So why not take a look at one of their aircraft? Right behind me is an F-4 Phantom that the Blue Angels used to fly during their demonstration period when that aircraft was active. So let's find out a little bit more about it. So come on with me. Let's take a walk around. The McDonnell Douglas F-4 Phantom II is a twin two-seat, twin-engine, all-weather, long-range, supersonic jet interceptor and fighter bomber, originally developed for the United States Navy. It entered service in 1961. Proving that it was highly capable, it also was used by both the Marine Corps and the Air Force. The Phantom is a large fighter with a top speed of over Mach 2.2. Wow. It can carry more than 18,000 pounds of weapons on 9 external hardpoints, including air-to-air missiles, air-to-ground missiles, and various bombs. The only thing that it did not have was a gun. The F-4 was built without a gun since it was thought that guns would no longer be needed in the era of air-to-air missiles. What a big mistake. Some F-4s were retrofitted with gun pods later in the Vietnam War. Take a look at the name underneath the canopy window here at the pilot seat. It's Commander Harley Hall. Why is that name there? Well, Commander Hall was the commanding officer of the Blue Angels from 1970 to 1971. And I want to tell you his story. All right, so after his tour as the commanding officer of the Blue Angels, he became the commanding officer of VF-143 on board the aircraft carrier USS Enterprise. On January 27, 1973, he and his radar intercept officer, Lieutenant Commander Philip Kinslinger, launched their F-4 Phantom on an attack mission against North Vietnamese logistics and supply vehicles. This was one of the last missions of the Vietnam War. Commander Hall aircraft came under intense anti-aircraft fire while attacking several trucks and was hit. He made an attempt to fly to safety, but minutes later his aircraft caught on fire. So both he and Lieutenant Commander Kinslinger ejected about 4,000 feet and were seen to land about 100 feet apart from each other. Commander Hall was seen moving about on the ground, discarding his parachute, but no emergency radio contact was made with either man. The probability of immediate capture was considered to be very high. Only Lieutenant Commander Kinslinger was released during Operation Homecoming in 1973. And that was the end of the Vietnam War when all the POWs were returned to the United States. Kinslinger reported that during the parachute descent, they did receive heavy ground fire, and Kinslinger was actually hit in the leg. The last he saw of Commander Hall as they touched the ground was that he was moving about. Now, there is an ongoing controversy regarding Commander Hall. Some claim that he was a high-value POW and has yet to be returned. Others say he was killed in action. Nothing has been definitively proven. So, cadets, what I want you to keep in mind is every time you see that black and white POW and MIA flag, think about Commander Harley Hall and all those other brave Americans who have yet to come home. It's real. Keep them in your thoughts. They are the true heroes, the people that we should always respect. Keep them in mind. Okay, let's shift gears. Let's learn a whole bunch more about the United States Navy Blue Angels. Chief Rouse, take it away.
All right. Thank you, Warrant Officer Sheets. Good morning, everyone. Today we have a presentation over the history and heritage of the United States Navy Blue Angels. Starting off with their formation, the Blue Angels were formed in 1946 at the request of Chief of Naval Operations, Admiral Chester Nimitz. They would serve as a flight exhibition team in order to raise the public's interest in naval aviation, as well as boost Navy morale. It wasn't until the team was introduced as the Blue Angels at a show in Omaha, Nebraska in July 1946 that they earned their now famous nickname. As we continue on into the 1940s, we learned that 3 months after the team was formed, the Navy Flight Exhibition Team performed its first flight demonstration on June 15, 1946. It was held at Naval Air Station Jacksonville, Florida, and led by Lieutenant Commander Roy Boris. In 1947, Flight Leader Lieutenant Commander Robert Clark introduced the now famous Blue Angels Diamond Formation, which is pictured below. Continuing on into the 1950s, we are told that in response to the Korean War conflict, the Navy actually disbanded the Blue Angels temporarily, and the team reported to Fighter Squadron 191. In October of 1951, Lieutenant Commander Roy Boris came back to reorganize the Blue Angels once again as a flight demonstration team. Then on Armed Forces Day in May of 1954, the Blue Angels performed for the first time with the Air Force's newly formed demonstration team, the Thunderbirds. The Blue Angels' first Marine Corps pilot, Captain Chuck Hyatt, also joined the team in 1954. During the 1960s, the team reached a large milestone when it performed its 1,000th air show in Lemoore, California on July 4th, 1963. In October of 1968, Lieutenant Mary Russell reported to the Blue Angels as an assistant public affairs officer and later worked as an assistant administrative officer. Russell was the first woman to ever serve on the Blue Angels team. During the 1970s, the Blue Angels performed their first South American airshow tour, and the following year went on tour in Asia, performing in Korea, Japan, Taiwan, and the Philippines. Moving forward into 1973, the team went on tour again in Europe, performing in Tehran, Iran, England, France, Spain, Turkey, Greece, and Italy. On December 10th, 1973, the Blue Angels flight demonstration team was reorganized and commissioned as the U.S. Navy Flight Demonstration Squadron in a ceremony held at Naval Air Station, Pensacola, Florida. As we move forward in history, during the 1980s, in November of 1985, Lieutenant Commander Donnie Cochran became the Blue Angels' first African-American pilot, which is another large milestone for the team. And on November 8th, 1986, the team completed its 40th anniversary and unveiled a new aircraft at the time, the McDonnell Douglas, now Boeing, FA-18 Hornet. During the 1990s, the team completed another large milestone when they flew their 3,000th air show in Grand Forks, North Dakota on September 7th, 1990. The Blue Angels became the first U.S. military flight demonstration team to perform in Russia, Romania, and Bulgaria in 1992. And in 1994, prior Blue Angels pilot, Commander Donnie Cochran, came back to lead the team and became the team's first African-American commanding officer. The team also celebrated its 50th anniversary in 1996, and was led by Captain Gregory Woolridge. As we continue on into our last time period here, we have the 2000s to present day. The team celebrated another milestone when Marine Captain Katie Higgins was selected to pilot the Blue Angels Lockheed Martin C-130T Hercules transport aircraft. She is the first female to become a Blue Angels pilot as she flies their transport aircraft. And in 2020, the team celebrated its 74th anniversary and was the Blue Angels' 34th year flying the Boeing FA-18 Hornet. Since 1946, the Blue Angels have performed for nearly 500 million fans. Next up for you guys, we have an equipment overview going through each of the different aircraft that have been used by the Blue Angels at one point or another throughout their history. So starting off when they were formed in 1946, they were using the F-6F Hellcat. The Hellcat is an American carrier-based fighter aircraft from World War II, and they were designed to counter the Japanese Mitsubishi A6M-0. They have a top speed of 380 miles per hour. Next, we had the F-8F Bearcat, which was used from 1946 until 1949. The Grumman F-8F Bearcat is an American single-engine carrier-based fighter aircraft introduced late in World War II. It served during the mid-20th century in both the United States Navy and the United States Marine Corps, with a top speed of 455 miles per hour. Next up, we have the F-9F Panther, which was used from 1949 until 1955 by the Blue Angels, and it is one of the United States Navy's first successful carrier-based jet fighters. It was armed with four 20-millimeter cannons and could carry a wide assortment of air-to-ground munitions. It has a top speed of 579 miles per hour. From there, the team transitions to the F-9F-8 Cougar, which was used up until 1957 by the team. The Cougar was a carrier-based fighter aircraft for the United States Navy and Marine Corps. Based on the earlier design of the F-9F Panther, the Cougar replaced the Panther's straight wing with a more modern swept wing design. This increased its top speed to 647 miles per hour. Next up, we have the F-11 F-1 Tiger, which was used from 1957 until 1968. The F-11 Tiger is a supersonic, single-seat, carrier-based United States Navy fighter aircraft. It was in operation during the 1950s and 60s with a top speed of 727 miles per hour. From there, the team transitioned to the F-4J Phantom II, which was used from 1969 until 1974. The McDonnell Douglas F-4 Phantom II is a tandem two-seat, twin-engine, all-weather, long-range, supersonic jet interceptor and fighter bomber. It was originally developed for the United States Navy by McDonnell Aircraft with a top speed of 1,473 miles per hour. Stand by to see it in action. All right. Hopefully you all enjoyed that. Next up, we see that the team transitions to the A4F Skyhawk II, which was used until 1986. This was the Navy's newest attack plane and smaller, lighter, and faster than all of its contemporaries. The little but powerful A4 flew with Navy and Marine Corps units, including combat missions during the Vietnam War. It had a top speed of 674 miles per hour. Stay tuned to see it in action. All right, outstanding. Hopefully you guys enjoyed that music by Van Halen. Next up, we are moving to a aircraft that hopefully some of you recognize, the FA-18 Hornet, which was used by the team from 1986 and up until 2020. The McDonnell Douglas FA-18 Hornet is a twin-engine, supersonic, all-weather, carrier-capable, multi-role combat jet designed as both a fighter and attack aircraft with a top speed of 1,190 miles per hour. Stay tuned to see it in action once again.
Yeah.
All right. I'm always impressed by the amount of talent and skill that those pilots have with those aircraft. The last aircraft we're going to be going over today is a new change happening to the Blue Angels in 2021. The team has actually transitioned to the FA-18 Super Hornet. The Super Hornet is a twin-engine, carrier-capable, multi-role fighter aircraft variant based on the McDonnell Douglas FA-18 Hornet, which we talked about previously. It has a top speed of 1,190 miles per hour, and the team is going to be performing for the first time with these new aircraft coming up soon. Thank you guys for listening and paying attention. I hope you enjoyed this presentation. I'm now going to be passing it back over to Warrant Officer Sheets.
Thank you very much, Chief Rouse. Very exciting stuff. Okay, cadets, we've been at it for a while. I think it's time to take a break. So get up off your seats, move around, and we'll see you in 10 minutes for some more Operation Trident Watch. Welcome back, everybody. I hope you had a good break. And I tell you what, it's very nice to be back indoors into the Operation Trident Watch command bunker versus being outside in the winter in Cleveland next to Lake Erie. So happy to be here. Eventually, I'll warm up. So I certainly hope all of you enjoyed that history segment of the Blue Angels and some in-flight videos. It's pretty exciting stuff. And I can tell from the comments, all of you are really into that. So let's take a look at some of the comments before we get to some of our special guests. So that being said, what's going on out there? Well, one of our constant contributors, Redneck Warrior, was saying that the F-18 is truly a thing of beauty. The engineering, the speed, the elegance of the aircraft is just marvelous. I want to fly it someday when I join the Navy. You know what? It's important to have some great goals, and you picked a fantastic aircraft. We're going to learn a little bit more about that, and we're going to learn a little bit more about what it takes to actually fly those good guys. So, you know, stay tuned. We'll see what's going on there. Another comment, again, from our friend Redneck Warrior, you know, glad to see everybody at the drill. And, you know, we didn't talk about this in the intro when I was outside, but this national drill, you can get 3 hours of online drill credit for being here. So there is an online assessment at the end. We'll talk a little bit more about that at the end of the broadcast. But everything we're covering today is in that debrief. So really pay attention. We have a lot of great stuff going on here today, and we really want you to get the absolute most out of it, okay? So another question is, how does that smoke work on the back of it, all right? So Captain Rimdowski was actually very nice to send a little bit of information that he received from the Blue Angels quiz book, saying that the smoke that you see trailing from the jets during the performances is produced by pumping biodegradable paraffin-based oil into the plane's exhaust nozzles, all right? We'll find out if that's actually true, but it sounds really good. And, you know, they're doing all the right things so you can see the aircraft, and they absolutely are not harming the environment while they're doing this. So it's all about skill and beauty and not having a big, you know, a carbon footprint. So it's all wonderful. Last thing, you know, it takes years of practice in order to fly an F-18. You know, you're absolutely right. You know, what we saw today was absolute skill and mastery. And I have a feeling we just might have somebody coming on board which could tell you a little bit more. So if that happens to happen, and it's going to, you know, ask some comments in the comment section and we'll get your questions answered, all right? Other people are asking, hey, have you seen the Blue Angels live and in person? And Cadet B. Jones was saying, yes, actually did see them in 2019 in Colorado. So that's great. And the fact that you saw them flying the legacy FA-18s, right? That's great. But as we learned today, they transitioned to the Super Hornet. That's a bigger aircraft. It looks kind of the same, but it really is quite different. And this is their first year doing this demonstration. So if you have the opportunity to see them live, it's absolutely worth your while. So make an effort, bring your friends. You will absolutely be impressed. Okay. And then one final comment. All right. So question was, when we show the A4 video, okay, what was the band playing in the background? All right, everybody, that was Van Halen. All right, so when that video came out in the 80s, and I was around during that time, okay, that was a huge hit, and that actually came out before Top Gun or any of that type of stuff. So putting, you know, upbeat rock music to choreograph Blue Angels flying, as you see when we did the FA-18 video, it all mixes together, adds to the excitement, adds to everything. So that was a huge monster hit on MTV back when they played actual music. But I'm glad you enjoyed that. And that indeed was Van Halen with Sammy Hagar. So it might have sounded a little bit different for you true fans of Van Halen. Okay, great. So why don't we move on to other portions of our presentation. That being said, I want to hand this over to Petty Officer Restovic. Stand by.
Good morning, cadets. I am Petty Officer Second Class Restovic. And we've been learning so much about the Blue Angels, and all this awesome information has to lead up to something awesome, right? Well, today, I'd like to welcome two very special guests. Lieutenant Commander James Cox, who currently flies Blue Angel number 4, and AT-1, or Aviation Electronic Technician, Pay Officer First Class, Edwin Nolasco. Thank you very much, gentlemen, for coming on today and giving our cadets a wonderful opportunity to hear from you, members of the one and only Blue Angels.
Well, thank you very much, Sea Cadets, for having us today. I tell you, the honor is truly ours to be able to be here with you this morning. We're just finishing up our winter training out here in the Imperial Valley in El Centro, California, where the team spends over 3 months, January through March, preparing for our show seasons every single year. Not only do we practice all of our flying skills, but as AT-1 will say, we practice everything that the team goes through, from our maintenance skills to getting the jets ready to everything that goes is involved with our air show season. So we could not be more excited about being here with you today, and we're ready to rock and roll.
Awesome. Speaking about cadets, remember to type in any questions in the comments to have a chance to have it answered by these awesome gentlemen. To start the questions off, Lieutenant Commander, I'd like to start with you. Could you please tell our cadets where you are from?
Yes, I was actually born and raised in a military family. I call Virginia Beach area home. My father retired from the Navy back in the mid-2000s there in Chesapeake, Virginia, just right next to Virginia Beach. So we've been there for the past 20 to 25 years, but grew up all over the country from California all the way to Florida. What about
you? Thank you, sir. I am from Los Angeles, California, so home and born and raised in Los Angeles, and that's where I call home.
Awesome. Thank you very much. AT-1, I'd like to start with you on the second question. Could you please tell us, why did you join the Navy?
Why did I join the Navy? The first reason was I didn't know exactly what I wanted to do in life. I know I wanted to work and have a trade, but I wasn't clear on what I wanted to do yet. So I knew that the Navy would provide me a trade and a career for my future, and that's why I joined the Navy, to have a trade and have a future and a career.
Awesome. Thank you very much. Now, Lieutenant Commander, could I ask you the same question? Why did you join the Navy?
Absolutely. Well, I joined the Navy to originally because I wanted to kind of follow in the family footsteps. My dad was a naval aviator. His dad was a PT boat, a driver, those patrol boat drivers in World War II, and both on my mother's and my father's side, long lineage of naval history. However, as I was joining, I realized that the bigger reason is just for to be able to be a part of something that's bigger than myself, to be a part of an organization that prides itself on teamwork and professionalism and commitment to duty, all the tenets of naval service. That is truly why I wanted to join, with ultimately my goal being aviation.
Thank you, sir. And to all our cadets, you heard that. That's what we live by too. So thank you, sir. Now, Lieutenant Commander, I'd like to start with you on our third question. Could you tell us a little about your career? Tell us where you were stationed before the Blue Angels, and what was the transition like from a normal pilot to a Blue Angel pilot?
Absolutely. So in a nutshell, I started, as most of you, I'm sure, have kind of read online, for not only myself, but for any of the pilots that are here on the team, and for most naval aviators, we'll start our training down at NAS Pensacola, where our team is currently stationed, for our aviation pre-flight indoctrination, which is short for API. This is essentially all of the ground schooling that the Navy teaches you in order to be prepared to fly an airplane. After completion of that, I went over to NAS Whiting Field in Milton, Florida, to fly the T-34 Mentor, which is just a single-seat propeller-driven aircraft that kind of teaches you the basics of being airborne. From there, we went to Meridian, Mississippi, or Naval Air Facility, Meridian, Mississippi, where we learned how to fly the T-45 Goshawk, which is the Navy's premier jet trainer aircraft. It's a single-engine jet trainer, and is a very capable platform to get us ready to fly the bigger jets, such as the Hornet, the Super Hornet, the Growler, and others of its like. Now, from there, I went to NAS Oceana to join the VFA 106 Gladiators at the Fleet Replacement Squadron there, where I learned over the course of a year to fly and employ the F-18 Super Hornet. I flew the two-seat variant, so I had a weapons system officer or a WISO in the back to be able to do everything that they do, from combat systems to radio usage and navigation, and did my first few deployments on with that squadron there, and then went to the Navy Strike Fighter Weapons School as for my shore tour as a tactics instructor there on the East Coast, where I ultimately joined the team in the fall of 2018. That's the Blue Angel team, that is. And then I moved down to NAS Pensacola.
That is awesome. Thank you very much, sir. That was a lot of information. So I hope all the cadets watching right now got that. That's such an awesome career. AT1, I'd like to ask you the same question. Could you tell us a little bit about yourself? Like, where were you stationed before the Blue Angels and what your transition from an avionics tech to the Blue Angels was like?
Yeah, definitely. I'll let you know about my career, my history. So I started off going to boot camp back in 2012 in RTC Great Lakes. So in Illinois, over there by the Great Lakes near Chicago. So I went there for boot camp, came down to Pensacola for A school, for Aviation Electronics Technicians A school. Spent about, I would say, 7 months there learning my trade. Eventually got orders to DFA 151, the Vigilantes in Lemoore, California, working on the single-seater F-18 Echo Super Hornet. Enjoyed my time there. I loved it. And I did one deployment with them and then eventually went back to NATSE Pensacola on NAS Pensacola as an instructor. So I was in an aviation electronics technicians instructor there for about 2.5 years and ultimately got selected to be part of the Blue Angels transition team to the Super Hornet. So I got selected to help them transition up to Super Hornet as a maintainer, and I was helping the Blue Angels, and I'm now part of the Blue Angels team showcasing this Blue Angels Super Hornet.
That's really awesome. It sounds like a lot of work, if I'm being honest, so that's really cool. Can I start with Lieutenant Commander? Could you tell us a little bit about your role as pilot number 4 within the Blue Angels?
Absolutely. Well, the number 4 position is a position that is held after you are number 3. So every year the team will select a new number 3 position. So that's the left wingman. After you've completed successfully, you're there, you'll move to the 4 spot, which is the slot. My role in the team is the squadron's training officer and airborne safety officer. So everything that happens within the diamond, which is Blue Angel 1 through 4, and then ultimately the Blue Angel Delta, so Blue Angels 1 through 6, when they join up for our final portion of the show. I am watching and observing and just kind of analyzing all of the different factors that happen to be present for an air show. So that's the air show site, the weather, the winds, the clouds, all that sort of stuff, to be able to make sure what we're doing over the airfield for the air show is first and foremost safe. And then on top of that, during our winter training cycle and in some cases during the air show, not only myself, but others on the team, we will collaborate to build a training plan for us. And we have the ultimate goal in mind of a safe and successful but good-looking flight demonstration in the beginning part of our show season, which is generally March or April timeframe. And we spend the months of January through March preparing for this flight demonstration. So we'll kind of tailor a plan to best prepare ourselves and to get the amount of training sorties, which are flights in military parlance, to prepare ourselves to fly for hopefully every one of you guys this year.
That's really awesome. And it sounds like a lot of work, but I mean, it all pays off because looking at all those demonstrations by you guys, they look immaculate. I don't know how you guys do it, but that's awesome. AT1, going over to you, I'd also like to ask you the same question. Could you tell us a little bit about your role in the Blue Angels team?
Yes, definitely. As AT1, I work in the Avionics Work Center. So that comprises of aviation electronics technicians and aircraft electricians. So I do not just work on my systems, which include displays, radar, communication, navigation, but also work on the electrical and wiring portion of the aircraft as well, as well as involved with the other work centers to make sure that we have these planes for, like, you know, for here, Lieutenant Commander James Cox here, to make those great demonstrations for you guys.
That's awesome. Thank you. Lieutenant Commander, I'd like to go back to you. What was your biggest personal challenge when becoming a member of the Blue Angels?
That's a fantastic question. Biggest challenge for me is was kind of with the time away from our friends and family back home. We are the training program that I was put through when I was a new pilot here was very rigorous and a pretty steep learning curve, but it was a ton of fun. And with every flight that we do, there's so much to work on. Even with the last flight that we did here over the field, like nothing that we do is ever perfect. No flight is ever going to be the flight that we just high five and say like, wow, we did it, because there is so much every single day, whether it's from the air or on the ground, that we need to work on to be just better teammates, better people, better pilots, better maintenance personnel. So we're constantly working to better ourselves professionally. But also from the personal side, we are away from our families quite a bit throughout the air show season. So that is something that we all have to deal with. But joining the team, we all kind of go through our own different challenges with that. But it is something that we're we are thankful to have the communication networks that we do, and to be able to be home a few days a week to spend time with our friends and family.
Thank you, sir. I think that's a wonderful point you made, all of those, but especially your first point about you can always become better than what you are. To all of our cadets watching, that is a really big point. You know, you can always continue learning. So thank you, sir, for mentioning that. AT1, I'd like to also ask you the same question. What was your biggest challenge when becoming a member of the Blue Angels avionics team?
My biggest challenge, I have to agree with Lieutenant Commander here, is striving to be perfect, but understanding that we won't always be perfect. That was, I would say, my biggest challenge on joining the Blue Angels team.
Awesome. I like that. Striving to be perfect, but you can't always be perfect. We should quote that. Now, I'm going to throw this one out to either of you. So I'd like to ask, like, open forum, but we stress teamwork in the Sea Cadet Corps. Could you give us a sense of teamwork and what it takes to put on a Blue Angels performance?
AT1, I'll let you start with that.
Okay. No problem, sir. Part of being a team is knowing where you can help out. Not everybody's going to be the same. But using those strengths and weaknesses to your advantage on the team. If you know something, you know how to do something well, and you see somebody struggling with it, you know, go out and help them out to become better, to get them to that level that you are at. I would say that'd be the definition of teamwork, just bringing everybody up so everybody can be the best on the team.
That's awesome. I love that. Like, always building each other up to make a perfect team. I think all of our cadets could really learn from that. Lieutenant Commander, we stress teamwork. So could you tell us, like, on your end, what teamwork is like in the Blue Angels?
Absolutely. Teamwork is a part of our mission statement on the team. So the essence of our foundation is built upon teamwork and professionalism. So it goes so much further than just being in the air, but also the trust that we have between our maintenance personnel, our support officers, and the pilots, or anyone that is affiliated with this organization. And what that really means is, let's take AT1 here, for example. When number 1 through 6 walk out to our jets, not only for a training sortie, but for a flight demonstration, we trust, just based on the teamwork that we have been able to provide here and build over our winter training, we trust that the jets that we are getting into are 100% ready to go. Because unlike a normal fleet squadron, we as the pilots are not doing an external pre-flight inspection. We are allowing our maintenance personnel to do that, and our teamwork is built upon that. So we get into the jets that they have prepared for us to go and fly for the day. So a tremendous amount of trust and a tremendous amount of teamwork put into getting these jets ready to go to ultimately put on a flight demonstration. And then once we get ourselves airborne, the teamwork aspect cannot be emphasized enough, where, you know, with the close formations that we do fly, everything that we do airborne, everything that we say airborne is built here in winter training. And we trust that the pilot that I'm flying off of, that number 2, number 3, number 6 are flying off of, are going to be very safe, very predictable, and in accordance with all of our safety precautions and all of our SOPs, or standard operating procedures, that we have built there. So we build that trust on deck first before we go fly to be able to make sure that every time we get airborne, we are safe, we trust our team more, or we trust our teammates, and everyone is predictable.
That's awesome, and I love that. Teamwork makes the dream work, and all the trust. I mean, all of our cadets, like, having trust in one another, like, that's very important. Now, I'd like to ask another, this is going to be the last one, but another open forum question. Do you have, I know the Blue Angels are both Navy and Marine Corps, so do you have any advice for anybody interested, for our cadets who are interested in joining either the Navy or the Marine Corps? I'd like, just throwing it out there.
Absolutely. Okay. Let's just start it if you want.
I'll start it. I would say if that's something that you're interested in doing, get some information on it, read on it, ask for advice. But I would say ultimately I would do it. I'm not saying that you have to, but for me personally, it's worked out well. I've got a trade, I've got a career, and it's worked out for me. But I would say any advice I can give you is, read up on it, get some advice, get more information on it.
Perfect. Thank you. And Lieutenant Commander, what would your advice be for anybody interested in joining?
What I would say is, first and foremost, if you wanted to get information on the Navy or Marine Corps, some of, if not the best sources of information for that are going to be through the recruiting commands that are local in your own individual areas of the country, or through the Navy's recruiting website, or simply just usnavy.com. They're going to be able to provide you with information on every sort of job that the Navy has to offer, from aviation to submarine service to technical expertise to public affairs to supply. The Naval Service is incredible in that it provides so many different avenues of professionalism and professional targets there that it is there is a job for everybody within the Naval or Marine Corps service. So I'd definitely start there.
Awesome. Thank you very much, sir. Now, transitioning over, I know our cadets who have been watching this have been really eager to ask questions. So yeah. I now know that we're probably going to display a few questions, and I will say those questions. So, Lieutenant Commander Cox, how many Gs do you usually experience during a demonstration?
Great question. That comes from Cooper Mears. Thanks, Cooper, for that that question. During a flight demonstration, the G profiles change depending upon your position. But each one of the pilots in our flight demonstration will pull up to 7.5 Gs during the course of the flight. The average G profile is somewhere in between 4 and 6, depending upon the maneuver, with 2 or 3 outliers being right at 7.5 Gs, which comes closer to our landing maneuver. So at the air shows this year, where you come and watch, the very last maneuver that we conduct prior to putting our landing gear down to land is called our pitch up break, which is a 7.5 G, 180 degree pull to position ourselves back to landing on the runway. That's a great question.
It's a lot of Gs, sir. That's awesome.
Yeah.
Our next question is from Captain Radomski. For both Lieutenant Commander Cox and AT-1 Nolasco, if you could tell your 15-year-old self one thing, what would it be?
Okay. I would tell my own 15-year-old self to remain motivated, strive for excellence. That's what I would tell myself.
That's awesome, and I agree. Lieutenant Commander, what would your advice be?
The advice for my 15-year-old self would be to always sweat the small stuff, especially when you're in school. So something that upon reflection, say that, you know, you have a goal, you're focused on long-term goals, but what really matters ultimately in achieving long-term goals is the near-term future. So when you are in school, you might not think that your Spanish test is as important if you want to be an engineer, or you might not think that your math test is going to get you anywhere if you want to be an artist or something like that, but it all matters. Every day, you just try to be the best person that you can be, the best student, the best daughter, the best son, the best friend you can be that day. And if you do that and build habit patterns of doing that over the course of your middle school, high school, college, then you will ultimately force yourself to becoming the person who achieves goals by those small steps that are kind of laid along the way.
Those are both awesome points of advice for your 15-year-old self. Thank you. And I know a lot of cadets have just learned a ton and will start to do what you have just said, sir, and AT1. Our next question is from Lisa Catherine. Sir, are there physical fitness requirements to become a pilot?
Thank you very much for that that question, Lisa. There are, so to become a pilot, there are obviously certain there are certain physical requirements that are required to be in certain types of aircraft, whether that be a helicopter or a support logistics aircraft or an aircraft such as the F-18 with an ejection seat. So there are certain limits to height and whatnot, but that aside, to fly the F-18 Super Hornet, the biggest thing is just to make sure that you have some sort of physical fitness, you know, baseline there, and are you have the ability to withstand the G requirements associated with a high performance aircraft.
That's awesome.
Yeah, ultimately, for physical fitness requirements to join Naval Aviation, the Navy is very, very good at tailoring programs to be able to have anybody fly an aircraft of their choosing.
Thank you very much, sir. And to all of our cadets out there, that means only one thing: practice for your PRT.
Yeah. That's right.
Our next question is from Wade Hoagland. How do you prep for a show?
Okay. So on the maintainer side, we come in early. We do a full, let's say, pre-operation on the aircraft, call them morning turns. So we check all the systems. Make sure everything's good to go in the morning. There's no hiccups for later on the show. And then we shut them down. We fuel them with jet fuel, and we get everything ready to rock and roll. We go out, we meet people, we engage the crowd. And then when the time comes for the show, we roll out to the aircraft, prep the aircraft. Like Lieutenant Commander said, they trust us, and we get everything ready for them. And the pilots come. We do the show, and then I'll take it from there.
That's awesome, AT1. If you don't mind, how early is early?
Early around, I'll say six or seven.
Not bad, AT1.
Yeah.
And sir, how do you prep for a show?
Well, we Wade, thanks so much for the question. We prep for shows in lots of different ways, both as a team and then personally. What we'll do as a team is we'll go through a very rigorous pre-flight briefing and airport area study, just to make sure that we have there are not any towers or any land masses or anything like that that can get in the way of our flight demonstration. And then we will review our air show site on a printed out sheet, which is done by Blue Angel 2. Of our aerobatic area over the airfield. So we will look and we'll identify any hazards or kind of see where the crowd is going to be and make sure that we're very familiar with the area. And then we will essentially mission rehearse, or we will go through our exact flight for the day, and we will kind of trace our path over the ground to be able to rehearse mentally where we are and where we're going to be for each maneuver. And then personally, I think each person has their own way of preparing for the flight demonstration. And for me, it just kind of is involved in some quiet time. You know, we'll all kind of sit in the quiet and just mentally rehearse what we're going to do for the day. We call it chair flying. So you'll sit in a chair and pretend you're actually flying an airplane. And that kind of gets your mind right for some of the maneuvers that we're going to be focusing on for that specific day.
That's really interesting. Thank you both for answering that. Our next question, I believe, is from Bella Rajiansky. My apologies if I said that wrong. When flying, on a scale of 1 to 10, how intense is the pressure?
Well, Bella, thank you so much. I'll answer the flying part, and AT1 will answer the airshow part there. But on a scale of 1 to 10, we talk about the pressure. You know, there's several different ways you can think about that. But from the Blue Angel perspective, our system here in winter training is quote pressurized to be able to allow us to do our flight demonstration over every city nationwide safely. So To put that on a scale would be pretty hard, because although the flight demonstrations themselves require a lot of concentration and a lot of attention to detail, from a pressure standpoint, we are all trained to the point where we don't get into the jets and get into the air and feel pressured. We feel prepared. So the pressure comes from the rigorous training regimen that we have out here, flying 2 times and sometimes 3 times every single day for 3 months for no less than 120 training flights out here in El Centro. So that's kind of how we prepare ourselves, both mentally and then physically, for the flight demonstration pressure, as you mentioned in your question. AT1, anything else to add for that one?
No, I think you said it well, sir. The pressure you feel here in training is to prepare us for the show season. So we don't really feel like the pressure, but it helps us to become prepared, like you said, for the season.
Thank you both. I think that's awesome. Being prepared has the best outcomes. I think we have one last question from the audience, and this is from Victoria Beard. She says, I definitely want to see the Blue Angels live. Do you guys know where you'll be this season?
Yes. Awesome. Victoria, well, we want to see you guys as well. We want to see everybody out there at shows this year. As of now, we've got a normal air show season. You can find the dates and the locations of all of our air shows from April all the way through November on the U.S. Navy Blue Angels .mil website. And you'll be able to go there and just click on schedule. And on our top page, it'll tell you where we're going to be for that specific weekend, and ultimately give you every air show location throughout the year.
That is awesome. Gentlemen, thank you very much for coming on today. It has been an absolute pleasure. All of us here at Operation Trident Watch and the Sea Cadet Corps learned a ton. I'd like to say have a wonderful day, gentlemen, and thank you very much again for coming on.
You're very welcome. The pleasure was really ours. It's humbling to be asked to come participate in something like this with such an incredible organization such as the Sea Cadets. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you all again for having us. It was a wonderful experience.
Thank you very much, gentlemen. You guys have a wonderful day and good luck on your season.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Enjoy your day, everybody.
All right, everybody. You can't get better than that, can you? So good conversations. Thank you, everybody, for asking questions. You know, it is really impressive to get the inside information from an aviator and a maintainer on that team to really give you that sense of people doing that job and how dedicated they are in order to bring their show to you, the public. Fantastic stuff. So let's do something different. And I want to pass on our discussion now to Petty Officer Gollinge and, Chief Gollinge and Petty Officer Payne, who's going to give us a presentation on additional information with Naval Aviation.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome. So today we're going to be talking about Naval Rotary Wing Aircraft. I'm Chief Gollinge, and with me is
Petty Officer Payne.
All right, cool. So just a brief overview of what we're going to be doing today. We're going to discuss the definition of a rotary wing aircraft, examine some examples of Marine Corps helicopters, and examine examples of Navy helicopters. All right. So let's define what a rotary wing aircraft is. A rotorcraft or rotary wing aircraft is a heavier-than-air aircraft with rotary wings or rotor blades, which generate lift by rotating around a vertical mast. Several rotor blades mounted on a single mast are referred to as a rotor. All right. In other words, it's a helicopter. All right. So that's a much more familiar term. Just helicopters. So we have a few examples of Marine Corps helicopters and a few examples of Navy helicopters to show to you today. All right, so let's get started.
Okay, so first we're going to be going over the examples of Marine Corps rotor wing aircraft. So our first rotor wing aircraft is the AH-1W Super Cobra. Okay, as you can see from this visual picture down on the right, that is the AH-1W Super Cobra. These helicopters are considered to be the backbone of the Marine Corps' Air Ground Task Unit, or MAGTAF. They are mobilized whenever they are called on. As we know with the Marine Corps, they are the first to fight. They're kind of the tip of the spear, so it makes sense that these helicopters are just ready to be mobilized at a moment's notice and engage in the ground. They provide close air support platforms for Marines fighting on the ground, and they are effective in coordinating attacks on the grounds, as the pilots can call in artillery and mortar strikes on any positions they spot from the sky. So these helicopters, when they are called to engage, they often orbit the battlefield, and from their eye in the sky, they're able to call out to the artillery and mortarmen on the ground, enemy targets for them to neutralize. So very cool how they all coordinate together. Some statistics about this specific helicopter: its max airspeed is 170 knots. Its range is 358 nautical miles. Its crew is made up of two personnel, a pilot and a gunner. Okay, so that is the first Marine Corps rotor winged aircraft. Let's move on to the next one. The AH-1Z Viper. This particular rotor winged aircraft is derived from the AH-1 Cobra that we just discussed in the last slide. The AH-1Z Viper functions as the primary rotor winged aircraft the Marine Corps uses to engage in ground attacks. So this is going to be kind of the go-to helicopter for the Marine Corps if troops came in contact and we needed something immediately. This particular helicopter is well equipped to provide armed escort. So say like a high value target or somebody needed to be transported somewhere, these types of helicopters would usually escort them. Anti-armor weapons. Okay, so their weapons are powerful enough to penetrate tank armor, ships, whatever they need to penetrate. It provides air support and recon support. So they fly on some recon missions and possibly stake out enemy compounds from the sky. So that's all pretty cool stuff. These aircrafts are built to thrive under the most adverse conditions, weather conditions, and throughout both the day and the night. As you can see, that is the AH-1Z Viper in the bottom right. And some statistics about this rotor wing aircraft: its maximum airspeed is 200 knots. Its range is 370 nautical miles, similar to the AH-1 Cobra. And it also can crew up to two personnel, a pilot and a gunner. And its load capacity is 12,300 pounds. Okay, moving on to the final Marine Corps rotor winged aircraft, the VH-60N. This helicopter functions as an executive transport helicopter. So if you've been watching the news in the past and you see the president coming out on the lawn of the White House, you usually see this helicopter here down in the bottom right, kind of transporting him to and from wherever he needs to go when he's not flying on Air Force One. So definitely really cool that I'm able to present about this helicopter, given that we see it a lot in the news and just whenever we see the president. So this helicopter is derived from the Army's UH-60 Blackhawk, as well as the Navy's SH-60 Seahawk aircraft. So the Marine Corps, they took a look at the Army's Blackhawk and the Navy's SH-60 Seahawk aircraft, which you're going to hear about next. And they just like, okay, we're gonna bring the best of both worlds and create our very own VH-60N aircraft. So it's kind of it's derived from both of them. The H-60 family of helicopters is utilized heavily throughout the DoD. So not just the Marine Corps, but also the Army, the Navy, the Air Force. These types of helicopters engage in anti-sub ship and submarine warfare, search and rescue missions, drug interdiction, cargo lift, and special operations. Some statistics about this aircraft: its maximum airspeed is 159 knots. Its range is 362 nautical miles. Its crew can hold up to 3 to 4. Okay, so usually a pilot, co-pilot, just an air crewman, maybe two air crewmen. And then its load capacity is 13,650 pounds. Okay, so that covers all of the Marine Corps rotor-winged aircraft examples. There are definitely a lot more, but these are just the three I chose to present on. So after drill is over, if you want to go on the internet and research some more, feel free to do so. But now I'm gonna pass it back over to Chief Gollins so he can give you examples of naval rotor-winged aircraft.
Thank you, Petty Officer Payne. All right, so let's jump into some Navy helicopters. All right. Starting off is the SH-60 Seahawk. So as Petty Officer Payne just mentioned, it's very similar to the VH-60, which carries the President. And it's also similar to the UH-60 Blackhawk, the Army version. And this is the primary medium utility helicopter in the Navy's fleet. It's a twin-engine helicopter, and it is used for anti-submarine warfare, search and rescue, drug interdiction, anti-ship warfare, cargo lift, special operations. It's pretty much the Swiss Army knife of helicopters for the Navy. All right. Its maximum airspeed is 180 knots. Its range is 380 miles, and it has a similar crew structure as previously mentioned, so 3 to 4. It can be attached with a hoist. So if it was doing any sort of search and rescue and needed to rescue somebody, a hoist and a basket can be placed in the bottom and have 600-pound capacity, or it can carry 9,000 pounds internally. Okay. That's the SH-60 Seahawk. Up next is the MH-53E Sea Dragon. So this is the U.S. Navy's primary aerial mine countermeasures aircraft. The MH-53 can operate from carriers and other warships and is capable of towing a variety of mine hunting or sweeping countermeasure systems. So this is a much larger helicopter compared to the SH-60. It's also slower and has a much greater range. So its airspeed is around 150 knots. Its range is 1,050 nautical miles, so a very long distance. Crew is typically 2 pilots and 1 aircrewman. It can also carry up to 55 troops or 32,000 pounds of equipment. So that's a lot of equipment. This is pretty much just kind of a pack mule. So anti-mine helicopter. This is primary purpose. If there's a situation where Navy suspects a lot of mines, and have this particular helicopter at hand, they're going to send a helicopter up to do its primary job. Okay. And then moving on, just last but not least, we have this CMV-22B Osprey. So some of you might recognize it, some of you may not. But the Osprey is a variant of the MV-22B and is the replacement for the C-2A Greyhound for the carrier onboard delivery mission. If you just excuse apologize for that interruption. It was pretty bad timing on whoever was calling the house. But moving on, the Osprey is a tilt rotor V-stall aircraft that can take off and land as a helicopter, but transit as a turboprop aircraft. So in other words, what that means is that the bottom right picture, you see it's in its helicopter mode. It can transition, and those rotors will actually tilt forward, and it pretty much turns into a plane. So, and then from the plane, it can also transition back to the helicopters. So very cool, very advanced sort of machinery that's being flown around. So its airspeed maximum is 280 knots, very long range with 1,150 nautical miles. Crew is around 4. It's got a pilot, co-pilot, and 2 crew chiefs, and it can also carry up to 24 troops, and has a 6,000-pound internal payload. So, very cool stuff. And honestly, this is probably going to be a future of new sort of helicopters and planes.
Okay, well, that concludes our presentation on Naval and Marine Corps rotor winged aircraft. Next, we are going to move in to a GIM kit. Okay, so we're going to lay out some instructions as soon as we get everything posted here on the screen. So reminder, you need to go to gimkit.com/live. Okay, I think we're going to put that up in a banner in just a moment. And the code is displayed on the screen. It is 34149. Remember, just go to the website on your computer or your phone. And then input the code, and we'll start here shortly.
This GIM kit is going to be going over not only information from Chief Gollinge and PO1 Payne's presentation, but it's also going to include some information from my presentation earlier over the Blue Angels.
Yep. So we have a lot of some diversity of information here. So I hope you're paying attention because we got information from everywhere.
All right, we'll give you guys a couple minutes to get in, and we'll go ahead and get started here shortly. Just to repeat the information for anyone who missed it, you want to go either on your computer or your cell phone to gimkit.com/live and enter the code 34149 to join our game.
If you have any additional questions about the instructions for getting on, just post them in the comments. I'm sure we'll get back to you real quick.
All right, and then for those of you that have not played a game kit before with us, the object of the game, there's going to be several different multiple choice questions that are going to be fed to you guys through the game kit website. And when you answer questions correctly, you will earn money for that inside of the game. You can use that money to buy upgrades to earn more money. You can buy power-ups that you can, let's say, freeze one of your competitors so they can't earn any money for 30 seconds. And the object of the game is to have the most money at the end of the game. Give it another minute or two for people still joining, and we'll get started. All right, looks like we have our last couple people coming in now. Remember, your objective is to make as much money as you can in the time limit. All right, let's go ahead and get started. You can join the game after we have started as well. The code is 34149. right, looks like Noah is taking the lead with $97. Keep up the good work, you guys. Remember, you can buy all kinds of upgrades to help your odds. Seaman recruit Kokidius in the lead. LC3 Liam McLeavy takes the lead. Keep up the good work, guys. We're just getting started. Lots of upgrades being bought.
Top three right now, we got Seaman Recruit, Kokiades, sorry if I butchered that, Seaman Recruit De Blasi, and Lieutenant Sweeney. Keep up the good work.
Frequent competitor Seaman Recruit De Blasi is in the top three. Chief Ileana.
He's jumping up there.
Chief Ileana takes the lead. Keep up the good work, you guys.
Yes, remember, you can ice people, take away money from them if you believe they've been in the lead for too long. So just keep that in mind.
Oh no, Chief Ilyarnov back in the lead.
Taken back by Seaman Recruit De Blasi.
Some upgrades being bought. Sitting just above $4,000 for leaders. Keep up the good work, you guys. She's a hard back in the lead.
$7,000. Keep bumping those numbers up.
Thomas, Chief Ilyarnov did not have access to these questions ahead of time. Keep up the good work, guys.
Seaman Apprentice Kraber getting into the top three. Keep up the good work. Now Seaman Buenaluz.
Again, Seaman Recruit of Lock. Taking back the lead. Keep up the good work, you guys. Upgrades being bought, keep it up. Let's see if we can not recruit de Blasi out of the leaderboard.
You want Roman taking the lead.
A total of
$1,000.
De Blasi is back in the lead. Do you feel like Arnold is still hanging in there? PO1 Roman takes the lead.
PO2 Juan just blurred Seaman Recruit Juan. Sounds like some brother sister rivalry there.
Like someone just got iced.
To $100,000. Good work. Team Apprentice Craver ices Seaman Recruit de Blasi.
It's like Chief is still coming for that number one spot. So is PO1 Roman.
Parenti blurred Chief Petty Officer Iliano.
PO1 Roman takes the lead. Keep up the good work, you guys.
Top three right now. We got Seaman Recruit de Blasi in first. PO1 Roman in second place, and Chief Petty Officer Ilya Arnov in third. Catch him if you can.
Total is over $300,000 so far. Chief Ilya Arnov back in the lead.
Seaman Recruit de Blasi with the lead.
Keep up the good work, you guys. Try and climb the leaderboard as much as you can. PO3, Harris gives a gift to Seaman
Recruit de Blasi. PO2 Juan ices Seaman Recruit Juan for a second time. A lot of people icing each other now.
Don't be afraid to use those attack power-ups.
We're up over $1 million. Keep up the work.
Uh, Lots of changes to our leaderboard. Good job, you guys. Paying attention and demonstrating your knowledge. $3 million. Keep up the good work, you guys.
Chief Petty Officer, the lead.
Keep up the good work, everybody. We're gonna end the game here in about 5 minutes. So make those final upgrades, final sabotages, try and climb as high as you can. Seaman Apprentice Sanders is still in the lead. Total is over 600, or pardon me, $7 million.
Like in the top three right now, we got Seaman Apprentice Sanders in first, Seaman Recruit de Blasi in second, and Chief Petty Officer Eliana in third.
Outstanding work, everybody. Sanders still in the lead. Over $15 million. We have just about 3 minutes remaining. Make that final push, everybody.
Over 20 million, keep up the good work.
Chief Iliarna back in the lead. Remaining. that final push to climb the leaderboard, you guys.
And they're all going after Chief Petty Officer Ilyarnov. Three right now. The first, we have Seaman Prentice Sanders. Second, Chief Petty Officer Ilyarnov. And third, Seaman Boyle.
Total is at $180 million. Just under a minute remaining. Keep up the excellent work, everybody. That was about 15 seconds remaining. Five, four, three, two, one, time. Congratulations to our winner, Seaman Apprentice Sanders. To our other medalists, Chief Ilyarnov and Seaman Recruit De Blasi. Thank you, everyone, for participating. We're now going to pass it back over to Warrant Officer Sheets.
Okay, everybody. That was a spirited run of GIMKIT. Hope you had a good time doing that. Again, you know, this is live, so whatever's coming across the internet, if we're having audio delays or we're having things happening, you know it's real, you know it's legit, it's what's happening. Sorry about that, but thanks for sticking with us, no problem. But you could see from the aggressiveness in that GIMKIT activity that you all really enjoyed it. Happy to see it. All right, so we're going to go to a break pretty soon. But before we do that, did you know that there is actually something called the Sea Cadet March? Yes, I know it's the month of March. And because of that, we are going to play a rendition of the Sea Cadet March done by our good friends, the Band of the West. So everybody, take a listen. Get up, march around, and enjoy our own Sea Cadet March. Thank you. Okay, admit it. That sounded pretty cool, didn't it? So that is the Sea Cadet March, everybody. Yeah, it's a real thing. So yeah, I hope you enjoyed it. All right, everybody. It's time to take a 10-minute break. We're going to take another 10-minute break, but don't just sit there. Get on your PT gear. Get your hydration kit, which is a cool way of saying get something to drink. All right. So get yourself ready to go. We have yet another exciting guest. Right? We have a great interview, some information that you're really going to enjoy hearing. But then after that, we're going to bust out some PT. So don't just sit there. Don't just like, you know, watch. Be part of it. Okay? So 10-minute break. Get on your PT gear. Get your hydration kit. And we'll see you back for more Operation Trident Watch. Okay, everybody, welcome back. Hey, let's do this thing. Let's bring in yet another special guest. Stand by.
Good morning, and thank you so much for joining me on this episode's edition of the CPO Interview Show. I have an incredibly special guest, a Sea Cadet legend, and a man to whom most cadets will need no introduction. I am very grateful to welcome Deputy Director Hull to the show. Sir, thank you so much for joining me.
Chief, good morning. Thank you. I've never been called a legend before by anybody. So thank you for that. And it's going to be hard to live up to it. But thank you and good morning to Operation Trident Watch.
Thank you, sir. Could you tell us a little bit about yourself and your Sea Cadet career?
Of course. So I'm a Boston boy. Grew up around Boston. So, Chief, it's good to connect with you and go Sox, go Pats. I joined the program when I was 15 years old, the Marathon Division in Buzzards Bay, Massachusetts, and joined with a friend of mine who's now the committing officer of the USS Fitzgerald, went to the Naval Academy. And when we walked in the drill site the first time, we noticed that this was the program for us. We knew it as soon as we walked in the room. I'm sure a lot of you have had that experience. You joined with a friend, came in with a peer, and you just knew that this program was the place that you fit in. And this is where I fit in. I also noticed that it wasn't everything it could have been. And my unit was good, but not great. And my volunteers were amazing people. I still have so much love and respect for them. But they didn't offer us everything that I think 15-year-old me was looking for. And so my friend Scott and I decided that we were going to step up. And so we started asking if we could teach. And I'll tell you, before that moment, I'm an introvert. I was so shy. At 14, 15 years old, I was still asking my mommy to order my chicken tenders for me out to eat. That was the first time I had to do any sort of public speaking. And the first few times I got in front of that classroom, God, I was so scared, so nervous. And but I learned that I loved teaching. And I actually went on to have a teaching career, despite my painful shyness and despite my introversion. And I learned that in Sea Cadets. I did have a chance to go to POLA, and I do want to tell you about that a little bit. I will never tell anyone where I went to POLA, but let's just say that was not the greatest training either. We were treated like we were in boot camp, except that we also lived in a hotel with maid service. We had about 1 hour of instruction a day from this great Navy Chief Petty Officer, who occasionally had a slight mental breakdown and would scream at us and run out of the room and come back 2 minutes later, clearly having been crying. And then we spent 2 days at a national historical site, which really doesn't have 2 days worth of stuff to look at. And at the end of the training, I was selected as one of the honor graduates, and I sincerely had no idea why, because there was no evaluation, no assessments. No one had ever actually practiced any leadership there. And so a seed was planted in my mind. Nobody must have known anything about how bad that POLA was, because I was selected to go back to recruit training and serve on staff in my second year in the program. And I got to tell you, that was the thing I wanted to do the most. And I sincerely hope that none of you have ever seen this movie, but I watched Full Metal Jacket about 150 times that year leading up to recruit training, because I was going to be Gunnery Sergeant Harp, and I knew exactly how I was going to handle those 13-year-olds. And I got to tell you, I got there, I practiced that for about 15 seconds and found out this doesn't work. This isn't the right tone or tenor. This isn't the right, you shouldn't treat people like that. And I had a great cadet mentor who saw me through that and walked me through the process. I had to learn on the fly and adjust myself. Again, another seed planted in my mind. I graduated from the program, stayed on as a midshipman, went to college a lot, got 4 degrees over the years, concluding with a law degree, and went on to become a professor of criminology and criminal justice and law. And during that time, I was able to continue volunteering for the program, and eventually ran 45 or 50 trainings, POLAs, recruit trainings, JAG, MAA, and medical. And in 2016, I was fortunate enough to be selected as the deputy director here at headquarters. But I want to tell you a couple of things about my adult career. And one of the first things I wanted to do when I was a commanding officer, I was only 22 when I took over Freedom Division, Canton, Massachusetts. And I was looking around to send my cadets out to POLA. The only one was available was the one that I went to like 7 years before. And I just couldn't do it. So I picked up a telephone. And again, as an introvert, it was hard to do. I picked up the phone and called the Senior Enlisted Academy at Naval Station Newport in Rhode Island, where the Navy's most senior enlisted teach the chiefs and senior chiefs how to be master chiefs and command master chiefs. And I asked them, hey, over your winter stand down, Christmas break, would you be willing to train some sea cadets in leadership? And they said yes. They couldn't believe it. And so what I did was I went there and I just, everything that I had done or was forced to do at that POLA 6 or 7 years prior, I just planned mine the opposite way. And I think we put a good program together there. But it was, I felt the pressure that I'm not going to let this cycle perpetuate. When I took over the recruit training in New England, let me show you this. This is my recruit manual from 1994. I know, I'm a Sea Cadet nerd. I'm a Sea Cadet dork. I get it. But this is it, man. I mean, it's like 14 pages long from a dot matrix printer, no graphics. I mean, it's in rough shape. When I met with the COTC that I was taking over from, he said, I've got great news for you. There's one thing you won't have to work on. We've got these great recruit manuals. They're ready to print. It only costs $40 for 300 kids. And he took that thing out and showed it to me and said, here you go. You're welcome. And I said, I just can't pass that on. So some of you have seen a version of this. This is the recruit manual. So I spent about, over the years, about 1,000 hours making this. And I made this in Microsoft Word. So if it looks crazy when you get your copy of it, that's why. And I apologize. But again, I just couldn't let that stand. And I'll tell you some other stuff that I've seen in the program, correcting behavior that's been going on for a while. And when folks hear about it, they say, oh, I've been telling him to cut that out for a long time. Here's the main lesson I've learned in my Sea Cadet career. You got to own it. All that stuff I did, I'm proud of it, but it doesn't get you a cup of coffee if you head into Starbucks, you know. But the lesson that I took from it is the most important thing. You got to own it. And when you see something going wrong at your unit, at your training, at school, at work, wherever you are, when you see something going wrong, you got to stand up and you got to say something. You got to do something. You can fix it. Don't come with complaints. Come with solutions.
Absolutely, sir. And that's a great message, I think, for all the cadets out there, doing the right thing, whether or not it's easy, but just doing the right thing to make sure it makes pretty much all situations better. And you're really doing a service to your cadets that way.
That's right.
You mentioned briefly that you've done or staffed 45, 50 trainings. I have a pretty hard question for you. And that's, if you had to pick a favorite training and why, what would you pick?
It's without a doubt, it's recruit training. And it's those opportunities I had as a staff cadet, as a chief, to actually interact directly. So as a, we used to call them assistant company commander, company commander. I think a lot of trainings now follow the Navy, call it recruit division commander. But those were absolutely my favorite experiences, getting to work with new recruits to teach them and indoctrinate them into the love of our Corps, to watch them turn into a team and to polish them from just raw recruits, brand new candidates into actual cadets. The sense of accomplishment and teamwork and pride, there's nothing like it. I really still look back on my two tours as an RDC as one of four of my favorite weeks of my life. And working as a COTC at a recruit training, you don't get to interact with the recruits, obviously, quite as much. But you do get a chance to work with those staff cadets, and watching those staff cadets develop is yet a separate accomplishment. Very proud of.
It is definitely a rewarding experience to be able to see the recruits go through the process, find their confidence, and find their abilities. I've had the privilege to staff both Fort Devens, where you were the COTC, and a recruit training Fort Devens, and later Pola, New England.
Nice.
And both of them were truly great trainings, getting to really mentor two different types of cadets, the cadets just joining and the cadets moving up in the program, and an amazing experience by all. Your legacy is well carried on there.
My legend precedes me. I'm glad to hear it.
With your work now at National Headquarters, what are some of your responsibilities and the parts you do at the program?
So as the deputy director, I'm like the executive officer for the entire program. And so I'm overseeing operations in the field up through the chain of command from the regional directors up to the headquarters representatives up to me. Overseeing the work of the headquarters directors. So there's a lot of boring stuff that you all don't want to hear about in lawyers and insurance and accounting and that kind of stuff. So I try to get that stuff over with by about 10 a.m. every morning to do the good stuff. And that's working with the training and education team. And we're really pushing as hard as we can to offer new curriculum. That's the most exciting thing. I got to tell you, folks, I had the same BMR in 1994 that many of you who joined more than 6 months ago took as a recruit. It's the same thing. And so we're just so excited to offer a new platform, Polaris, to offer the new curriculum rollout that precedes. And those are really the most exciting things. Working to create new partnerships with like the National Flight Academy down in Pensacola to offer training. This year we're partnering with Space Camp for the first time to send Sea Cadets to subsidize some cadets to go to Space Camp. So those kind of opportunities really are the bread and butter. Make me happy to get up in the morning.
Those truly sound amazing, and perhaps we can touch on them a little bit later.
Please.
What advice would you give to new chiefs and PO1s entering leadership positions?
So I'm so glad you asked that, because the thing I want to push to our petty officers and our chiefs is that you're moving from leadership to mentorship. So leading people, of course, is influencing them to want to achieve the goal that you're setting, right? And so by motivating them, rewarding them, by getting them to work together as a team coherently, that's leadership. But the next step beyond leadership is mentorship, and that's to create new leaders. And so the thing that is most important for our senior cadet leadership is to remember that you shouldn't tell them what to do. You should teach them how to decide what to do. You shouldn't set their goals for them. You should help them set the goals and then help them focus on achieving those goals. You have to push people beyond their own limitations. Shy guy, you got to get over it. Get up and teach. And this is the tough one. This is probably the toughest one. You have to tell people, you have to let people make mistakes and then learn from those mistakes. So if we're not going to hurt anybody, we're not going to cause a lawsuit, then go ahead and let people make mistakes and they can learn from them. And don't punish people for honest mistakes. When they make a mistake because they're trying something new, you got to take them aside and say, okay, it didn't work. Let's figure out how to do that better next time. But don't punish them for honest mistakes, because then they'll never innovate. You got to help them identify obstacles in their path and how they can clear them for you. But the trick is, you need to teach them to do their job as a senior leader. More importantly, you need to teach them how to do your job. You're gone. If you're a PO1 or a chief, you're gone in about 18 months, 2 years max. So you got to make sure that the people who are coming up behind you know how to do your job, So you need to teach them how to lead. And then as they get to be senior leaders, you have to teach them how to mentor as well. And so it takes a lot of work. And it's a lot more stressful to lean back and let them try. And again, to let them make the mistakes, it's a lot more stress on you. But at the end of the day, you're going to create better leaders and then better mentors for their next, their up and coming.
That's truly some great advice. Having been able to see a little bit of that and be mentored by that, I can say it truly is a helpful experience that really gives you a chance to do leadership with someone there as backup to help you out in those situations. Fortunately, we are coming to a close. In the next 5 or so minutes, could you touch on maybe where you envision Sea Cadets going in the future?
I'd love to. So the first one is, let's talk about the near term, the next few months. I'm so proud of people who are, again, owning this program, taking it by the bull by the horns here, Warren Ostersheets and Ensign DePippo and their team with Operation Trident Watch. Again, when you see a need, you see a problem, they step up and fix it. That's amazing. But I know everybody on this drill right now wants to get back in person. Look at the news, look at the numbers, they're getting better. I have great optimism that this summer we're going to be back training in person. May not be able to get to all the same facilities that we've been able to get to in years past, especially earlier in the summer, but we're going to train in person this summer. We're going to get you there. So have some faith, look forward to it. And if, by the way, speaking of mentoring, you have cadets at your home unit who have never been to an in-person training, and you need to take them under your wing and tell them a little bit about what it's going to be like. If all they've ever done is like a phase two RT, you need to help them out and understand this is what it's like to go to an in-person training. There's nothing like it. It's the best part of what we do. So I want you all to look forward to coming up the rest of this year. In the medium term, we're going to be wrapping up our curriculum project. So E4 is in the pipeline. It's being reviewed right now. E5 is written. E6 is in draft. We've got E7. And then I think you've all heard that we are also rolling out E8 and E9 later this year. I'm not making any promises about what the dates are. I know everybody who's a chief and a pit officer first class right now is going, when is that coming? But it's coming this year. We're going to publish some of the requirements for that sometime soon. But I thought if I can do a little show and tell for you, we've got these back from Vanguard. That's what the insignia are going to look like for the collar device. We're also going to start wearing these on the combo covers. And on the dress blues, we've got these as well. So we're working on it. And we're not doing it just because we can or just because we want to. We're doing it because we have more for our chiefs, senior chiefs and master chiefs to do. And the heads up is they're going to be super competitive. None of the requirements for the lower rates are going to be reduced. And so you're going to have to do all this potentially in your junior and senior year. And we're going to ask you to be leaders for and mentors for your region, in your area, and for the entire country. So your responsibilities as a senior chief and master chief may change drastically compared to what you're asked to do as a chief at your home unit. But those opportunities are out there, and we're excited to push them. Longer term, so in the next 2 years, we're going to start rolling out, haven't decided exactly what we're going to call them yet, specialties, ratings. We're probably the only Sea Cadet program in the world that doesn't have specialization tracks. And so we have our core curriculum, which is the general military training, leadership and ethics, civics and history. And then we're going to start rolling out specialty ratings. So these would be maritime, aviation, medical, STEM, public safety are probably the first batch. And we'll require you to do a Polaris specialization course, an online course, probably two advanced trainings in the same field. Most of them will require an external certification. So medical, for instance, would require a first aid, CPR, AED kind of certification to go with it. And at the end, when you finish that, badge, something on the sleeve, we're figuring that out right now. We're going to make sure that folks are recognized for that extra work and allow cadets, again, that element of choice in their track. The fourth one that I do want to mention is related to these others. This program is still on the move. We got kicked in the butt by COVID last year, as did everybody. But I want to remind you, this program is pushing forward. It's going to keep getting better. It gets better because of cadets like Chief Ilyanov here and Warrant Officer Sheets and his team. And I can't thank people enough for that. But everybody needs to be a recruiter in this program. You need to get people in here. And it's not so headquarters can have a bunch of cash from your enrollment. That's not what we're looking for. What we're looking for is to be able to spread the good work that we do here. And you all know that your units and trainings are better when there's more cadets. Leadership opportunities are more meaningful, more mentors. And you need students to have a meaningful mentor relationship. So I want everyone to go out and help us to recoup some of the losses that we had in 2020 due to COVID and get us back to where we were in 2019. Big step in that is going to be trainings coming up this summer. So get on home port, find the training list on there, on the training tab, and pick your trainings. Let's get signed up and let's train this summer.
I think almost every cadet, if not every cadet, just rejoiced at the news of trainings finally coming back more in full swing this year, and certainly exciting news with, in the short-term future, Master Chief and Senior Chief and ratings in the long term. All of this, such interesting and great initiatives that I think the Sea Cadets are really going to enjoy. And that's a very important message at the end, that if you know someone who you think may like this program, may learn something from this program, you think they would benefit at all, let them know, show them around, maybe invite them to come to your unit to see a drill. It's incredibly important to get the message out there. Sea Cadets is such a small program and shielded away in a way that Boy Scouts or something like it isn't. So make sure people are aware of what the program is and what it does and get the message out there.
Absolutely. And don't forget, if you have cadets who left last year because, hey, nothing was going on, remind them, we're opening back up for business. Get them back in.
Great advice. Thank you so much for joining me, Deputy Director Hall. Unfortunately, that is all we have time for. This was a great session. I'm so glad you were able to make it. Thank you for being here.
Thank you. It was an honor and a privilege. Appreciate it. Just ask everybody to stay safe, take care of each other, and stay on target.
Okay, everybody. I hope you enjoyed that presentation. Again, thank you very much, Deputy Director Hall. A lot of good information coming out of there. Great job with the interview, Chief. Cadets, you know, we're getting over the hump now, right? Our mission here in Operation Trident Watch is only temporary, to get us out of this virtual world into in-person drilling, and that's where we want to be. So it's all about the physical. It's all about training. It's all about having that one-on-one experience with yourselves and your shipmates, and that's where we're going. So stick with it. We're getting close. So talk about that one-on-one experience, physical activity. Hey, everybody, why don't we do some PT? So I'm going to hand this over to our PT monster crew. All right, Petty Officer Payne is going to get everything going with us. Everybody in the audience, you better have had your PT gear on. You better get your hydration kit. You better get off your seat, because we're going to get those sweat pumps moving. So Petty Officer Payne, take it away.
Welcome, everybody, to the moment you've all been waiting for. Okay, across the day, the adrenaline's been pumping throughout the morning. Okay, we've watched videos and spoken with members of the Blue Angels. We played Gimkit. Now it's time for an intense PT session to work off some of that adrenaline. So to start, I'm gonna just go through the basic layout of the workout. Okay, it's gonna last about 20-25 minutes. Okay, first we're gonna be starting with a 2-minute warm-up session. Then there's going to be a 7-minute exercise session. And in between the two segments, there's going to be a 2-minute hydration break. Okay, then there's going to be another 7-minute session. And then we'll end with a 2-minute cool down. Okay, and as you can see here with the other staff joining me on the left, it is not coincidence that these are the same three company leaders of Poseidon Strike that we have held over the past couple of months. Okay, there is some real strong tension between these three. Okay, they've been competing a while. So we want you to be the judge in our comments of who you think is performing well and who might need to work on their push-up form. Okay, so obviously don't comment while the workout is in progress. We want you to be engaging in the workout and not typing on your computer. But when we reach that 2-minute hydration break, we want you to load all of your comments, motivation to your preferred company commander, advice you might have for them to better perform in the workout, whatever you want to say that is appropriate. Okay. So make sure you got a wide open area and you're there so where you can work out. Okay. And you have some hydration right beside you, because we're not going to waste any time. We're going to get right into it. Okay. So we're going to start with the warm up. We're just going to start with some high knees. Okay. So get to your spot and start getting your knees up. Real high, 90 degree angle. There you go, keep going. We'll do about 10 more seconds. Okay, stop. Now we're gonna be doing some butt kickers, okay, just like this. Trying to kick your butt. Get those feet up. About 10 more seconds. Okay, stop. Now we're going to have some arm circles. Okay, so we're just going to be doing medium arm circles forward. Get those shoulder muscles stretched out. Can alternate between small circles and big circles. Okay, about 10 more seconds. Okay, and then go back. Really get good rotations. You're going to need it for when we get into the main workout. Get those muscles burning. Okay, now we'll stop. Okay, the final warm-up stretch, we're going to be doing something called fire feet. So if you've ever done this before, you're just quick chopping your feet. Okay, and then I'll say jog. You'll just jog in place, and I'll say fire feet again. And quick chop your feet. So start that now. Fire feet. And jog. Okay, fire feet. And jog. Okay, fire feet. And jog. Okay, stop. Okay, that concludes our warm-up session. I know I'm already starting to get the heavy breathing. Okay, so but now we're going to go straight into the main workout. Okay, a banner is going to be posted with the sequence on the bottom of your screen. That's going to be the order of exercises we do. So we're going to go for 7 minutes. Okay, just continuous through the sequence. And we're going to do it together. So if you're a little lost, just watch me. I'm gonna start the timer here in just a couple seconds. We're gonna start with 10 push-ups, okay? So get in position. 3, 2, 1, begin. 10 push-ups. Okay, back up on your feet when you're done. Okay, now we're gonna be doing flutter kicks. Okay, so you're gonna lay down on your back. You're just gonna be doing 10 flutter kicks each side. Start. Okay, back up on your feet when you're done. Okay, next one is 10 jump squats. Jump squats look like this. Okay, you're just immediately jumping to squat, so start that now. Okay, back up on your feet when you're done. Next one is 10 bicycle crunches. Bicycle crunches, kind of curl up like you're gonna crunch. Then you're just alternating your opposite elbow to your opposite knee. Start now, 10 each side. Back up on your feet when you're done. Okay, we got about 5.5 minutes, back to 10 push-ups. Back up on your feet. Okay, now we got 10 flutter kicks. Okay, back up on your feet. Okay, now we got 10 jump squats. Give you a second just to finish up, okay? 10 bicycle crunches. Back you up on your feet when you're done, straight to 10 push-ups. Okay, 10 flutter kicks now. Okay, 10 jump squats. Okay, now to 10 bicycle crunches. Back up on your feet when you're done. Okay, catch your breath. A little under 3 minutes, back to 10 push-ups. Get back up when you're done. Now we got 10 flutter kicks. Okay, and when you get back up on your feet, 10 jump squats. Be sure to be watching those Chiefs and Petty Officer Rastavac, see how they're performing. Okay, 10 bicycle crunches. Okay. Back up on your feet when you're done. Straight to 10 push-ups. Got about a minute and a half left. Okay, back to 10 flutter kicks. Okay, and then to 10 jump squats, less than a minute. Okay, and then next we have bicycle crunches. Back to 10 push-ups. All right, we got about 5 seconds left, so get up, recover. Time's up. Okay, we are now going to give you a 2-minute hydration break. So make sure you get some fluids in you. And come back for the second half. Good job, shipmates. Okay, remember, now is the time to start commenting as much as you can, telling which of our three cadets on the right are doing the best and which ones need some work. So unload it right now. This is going to be like one of your only chances.
That's what I like to see. Thank you for the support. Keep up the good work at home too, you guys.
Looks like we got a lot of support. You should feel the sweat just really drenching down your face and into your shirt. It's just like you just got out of the shower, so keep up the good work. Okay, we're gonna get started here in about 20 seconds. So get back to your positions. Since we ended off of push-ups off our last set, we're gonna go straight into the flutter kicks. Okay, I want you to work your arms, but I don't want you to be too sore. So, okay, give me just a second here to set my timer. Remember, we're going straight into flutter kicks in 3, 2, 1, go. Okay, back up when you're done, straight into your jump squats. Okay, then when you're done with that, moving straight into our bicycle crunches. Back up when you're done, straighten to push-ups. Okay, and then it's a flutter kicks. Okay, then it's a jump squat. Those jump squats should really be burning right about now, but let's get into bicycle crunches. All right, about 5 minutes left. Don't stop now, keep going. Back to push-ups, 10 of them. Then some flutter kicks. Remember. Okay, back up, go to jump squats on my desk. Okay, then to bicycle crunches. Back to push-ups. Flutter kicks. If you need to take a breath for a couple seconds, it's all right. All right, jump squats now. Little under 3 minutes, okay, bicycle crunches. Okay, now back to push-ups. All right, then some flutter kicks. All right, back up on your feet. Now we got jump squats, a little under 2 minutes. Okay, now to bicycle crunches. A little over a minute, 10 push-ups. Won't stop now. Straight to flutter kicks. Less than a minute. Straight to your jump squats. Come on, last push. And to your bicycle crunches. Okay, and as many push-ups as you can in these last 5 seconds. Time. That's time. All right. Good job. Okay, take a solid couple of seconds to catch your breath. Okay, we're gonna move into our cool down stretches. So really stretch your muscles back out. All right, let's sit down. If you're not drenched in sweat right now, did you do the workout? I know all of our cadets there on the right can relate. All right, so left leg out and stretch. Okay, and switch. Put your right leg out, curl your left leg in, and then reach to your toes. Okay, let's go to our butterfly stretch. So just put your feet together, bring them in, and just lean forward a little bit. Really feel that stretch in your hamstring. Okay, now we're gonna do our Hollywood stretch. So you're gonna put your left leg out. You're gonna pick up your right foot, put it over your left leg, and push against your right knee with your left arm. Okay, and switch. So right leg out, grab your left foot, put it over your right, and push against your left knee with your right arm. Okay, now let's do our quadricep stretch. So we're gonna sit up in like a crab position, whatever you wanna call it. We're gonna bring our right foot and put it on top of your left knee, and then just squat your butt to the ground, but don't touch the ground. Should really be feeling this one in your quads. Okay, and let's switch. So I'm back to your crab position, left foot on top of your right knee, and squat barely above the ground. Okay, so that's gonna conclude our cool down stretches. I hope I really got the blood pumping for you today. If you don't feel you worked out enough, you can go for a run. I'm sure it's a nice day in most parts of the country. But thank you for joining me in the House of Pain. And I'm going to pass it back over to Warrant Officer Sheets. Thank you, guys.
Petty Officer Pain, excellent example of leadership, bringing everybody going. Saw a lot of good workout from our cadets on screen. For those of you who are joining us remotely, I hope you were part of it. Looking at some of the comments that are coming through, I could tell many of you were trying so hard to keep up with Petty Officer Payne. Not an easy thing to do, right? But I hope you got a lot out of it. It's a great way to get yourself back in shape. And as Deputy Director Hall said, hey, you know, trainings are opening up, right? You need to be physically ready to go when these trainings are open. So try that workout or try something like that to get yourself in place, ready to go, so that when the green light's out there, you're all part of it. Okay, so let's wrap everything up with a few closing remarks for today's drill. All right, after action report. Seriously, how cool was today, right? I mean, seriously, right? Okay. That was on my bucket list. We had the Blue Angels on our broadcast today. I mean, that's fantastic. You know, they're very busy right now with their winter training schedule. Tomorrow, they're flying out of California where they were right now. They're in El Centro, flying back to Pensacola, right, to get ready for their season when they're flying the Super Hornets this time. The fact that they actually took time out of their busy training regiment to talk to us, Sea Cadets, is a tremendous honor. So if you joined our broadcast in the later hours, go back and watch the replay, see the history of the Blue Angels, and watch that interview session that we had. Really exciting stuff. Really thrilled that they spent time with us. Then we did another session focusing on rotor wing aircraft, helicopters for Naval Aviation, had a good spirited GIM kit with that. And then we had a detailed conversation with Deputy Director Hall from National Headquarters to let you know where we are with the program, what to look forward to, and all the exciting stuff which is coming your way for remaining and being active in the Naval Sea Cadet Corps. And finally, what you just saw, a great PT session. You should all be sweating right now, okay? So great session. Thank you, Petty Officer Payne. You know, really enjoyed it. I think everybody really got some good motivation, good workout on that one. All right. So, as you know, for those of you who have been part of this monthly drill, Operation Trident Watch, or those who are new, you get 3 hours. That's right, 3 hours of monthly drill credit just by filling out our after action report. So where is it? If you go into the description area on either the YouTube channel feed or on the Facebook feed, you'll see the link to this assessment. It's 10 questions. And those 10 questions were covered today in our broadcast. Actually, there was one I know that wasn't, all right? Do a little bit of research. It's simple. It's no big deal, all right? It helps you dig around a little bit and find just a little bit more about the Blue Angels. So go in there, do that, okay? But cadets, I beg of you, before you fill out this online assessment, know your email address, okay? Also, know your email address of your commanding officer and actually type them in correctly, because the system grades and it gives information back to you for your results based upon your email address. So if you mess that up, you're not going to get your results. To the officers out there, if you have cadets who are telling you that they have indeed taken some of these online assessments for Operation Trident Watch and you haven't received any results, get back in touch with me. You know how to do that. Get in touch with me. I have the results. I'll help you out. So we want everybody to get credit, even if you did end up making a mistake entering that. So when you get your results, get them entered in Magellan, get your 3 hours of monthly drill credit, and feel the accomplishment of doing that. Okay, feedback. We are doing this for you, okay? So if you have good suggestions of things that you would like for us to cover in our final couple sessions of Operation Trident Watch, let us know. Leave a positive comment. We always like those, right? Or send us an email at operationtridentwatch@gmail.com. We do take feedback. We incorporate it in subsequent drills because we are doing this for you, and we want you to get everything out of it. What's the next opportunity? We're going to be doing this again in April. So on April 13th, set your calendars. If you've already subscribed, right, and you've hit the like button and you have us with the notification bell, you'll know that this is going to happen. So subscribe. Hey, it's 7 years of good luck. Put a smile on a puppy's face. Subscribe, hit the notification bell so you'll always know what's happening. But if you can't do that, mark your calendars for April 13th. We will do this again. So we all thank you very, very much for participating in today's Operation Trident Watch. right? It was great serving you. It was great hearing that wonderful information from the Blue Angels and Deputy Director Hall and everybody involved with our program. So that being said, we're going to retreat the colors. Everybody have a great rest of your weekend, and we'll see you next time on Operation Trident Watch.